This volume is titled Hot Pursuit because it concentrates on the relentless drive of two great American armies, the first and the third, as they fought their way across France and into Germany from the beaches of Normandy. They were, as news commentator Charles Collingwood has said, the wedge that drove straight to the heart of Germany. The first episode covers General George S. Patton, Jr., who commanded 3rd Army. This colorful, impetuous leader, who had commanded the 7th Army in Sicily, had orders to pursue the enemy eastward after the breakthrough at St. Lo. Patton did just that with a gusto. He unremittingly pursued the retreating German Wehrmacht until his rapid pace took the 3rd beyond the reach of its supply lines. Out of gas, it had to halt temporarily, just short of the Saar.
In Europe, the 3rd U.S. Army bore the code name of Lucky. Their luck was that they never depended on luck to win a battle. They knew the one way to bring a bitter war to a quick end was to destroy the enemy in the field. Smash and knock out his materiel and firepower. To wipe out, rout, or capture his manpower. To liberate the enemy-held town and restore them to their loyal citizens. 3rd Army's 6 different corps were covered in the air by 9th Air Force's 19th Tactical Air Command. Men came from every state in the Union, wearing patches of those divisions, which at various times during the 281 fighting days in Europe served under 3rd Army's command. General George S. Patton, commanding general of 3rd Army, had his design for combat. Hit the Germans, hit them again, keep them off balance, confuse them, discourage them, drive forward, always forward. Soldiers were conditioned toward one objective: get that German first. Surprise, skill, power. The triad for victory against a strong, well-trained enemy. While 3rd Army was landing secretly at Utah Beach, gathering its strength quietly, moving forward quietly, 1st Army contained Normandy, this side of the French town of Avranches. Security measures were so good that when the 3rd Army breakthrough came at Avranches, it came as a complete surprise to the Germans. In the first shock, the Germans rushed to give themselves up. They came in from all directions. Materiel and great stores of supplies were destroyed in that initial breakthrough. Its success separated Brittany from the rest of German-held France. 3rd Army headed in 3 directions, fighting in 3 directions at one time. West to Saint-Malo and the port of Brest, south to Rennes, the capital of Brittany, and east toward Paris. Captured German films show, however, that the German armies were anything but a pushover. They had trained, disciplined, seasoned troops. Frightened towns had been easy prey for the Germans. Now they fought hard to hold what had been so easy to take. But nothing stopped the onrushing 3rd Army. 3rd Army headed for the coast town of Saint-Malo, key point in the enemy defense line. They battered it with heavy guns, sent their riflemen into the town. Fought the Germans from street to street and from house to house. dug them out of the solid stone houses, each a fortress in itself. Killed them in cellars like rats. Third Army captured the town. One enemy stronghold still held out. The German clung to his fortress on its offshore island. Third Army pounded it, turned some of the Germans' own guns against it. To prevent needless death and destruction, Third Army improvised a truce plane and flew it to the island with a plan of surrender. The Germans chose to ignore it. Third Army concentrated on a swift reduction of the fort. 19th Tactical Air Command blasted it from the air, swooped over the island, dropped its belly loads of eggs, sent this spectacular line of waterspouts into the air. Heavy artillery laid down fire that quickly reduced the fortress to helpless rubble. The Germans gave up. San Malo surrendered. The way was open for the drive toward the west. Third Army was on its way to the Brittany port of Brest, with its great German submarine base on the Atlantic. In all this fighting, ground troops, supported by tanks, set a pattern for combat. Typical of the French towns next liberated by Third Army was the German-held city of Rennes, capital of Brittany. American paratroopers, previously taken prisoner by the Germans, were released. French mademoiselles left no doubt about their feeling for the American liberators. Heroes fared well. Frenchmen brought out their best vintage wines for men of Third Army. A French-American entente cordiale was reestablished. The mayor made a speech. In quick succession, the French towns were freed. Third Army took the rules of the game laid down by the Germans themselves, and then beat the living daylights out of them at their own game. This was the beginning of the Germans' blitzkrieg in reverse. The Loire River, with its stronghold towns, was the next objective. Third Army now most definitely knew where it was going and hadn't the least doubt about getting there. They were on their way. The swift advance posed a tremendous problem in logistics. 250,000 men had to be fed, clothed, equipped, bedded down every day. Trucks and tanks needed gasoline. Every pound had to be hauled and lugged. Men of the transportation units made their great contribution to victory in this Battle of France. In the west, Third Army stepped up the attack on Brest. Monster guns pumped shells into that port and wiped the German submarine menace from the Atlantic sea lane. The commander-in-chief, General Eisenhower, viewed the progress of battle and found it good. Brest surrendered. All through the fighting, Third Army had tight support from the 19th Tactical Air Command. The 19th wove a net of protective air cover that caught any foolhardy German aircraft in the meshing, chased it scurrying back to the ground, or knocked plane and pilot completely out of the air. They kept the air lanes free for our own bombers. Expert skiff bombing was developed that sent hits skimming along the ground into tunnels and caught the few precious supply trains the Germans still could operate, strafed them, blew them up. Deep rivers brought out Third Army engineers. Pontons were lined up. Prefabricated Bailey Bridge sections were laid. Steel fairly walked across the water. Construction gangs and Bailey bridges weren't always at hand, but the enemy Germans were. They clung to these natural defenses, made crossings an invitation to sudden death. Third Army's war, at times like this, narrowed down to the close confines of a personal matter, bullet for bullet. Third Army men usually got their objective. But not always without damage. Teamwork in the Third Army started from the ground up. Individual disaster became company concern. With the town of Troyes in their hands, Third Army came into the area of well-remembered names of World War I. Troyes, Reims, Verdun, Nancy. Each name carried grim memories. Here they were, all again, and once again, all under fire. Reims, with its famous cathedral, bolstered and protected by sandbags. Once again, Reims became one of war's major targets. Verdun. Third Army men who had fought in the First War and remembered Verdun for its mud and rain now saw it again. Third Army had another date waiting for it. The Fort Ring city of Metz. The Germans made it their showpiece. It was advertised as the impregnable, unbeatable stronghold of the master race. The town had never in modern history been taken by assault. Third Army now went out to do just that, direct penetration. They blasted the forts and battered the town in one of the bloodiest of actions. The forts were knocked out. Third Army had no cheap victories. The Germans fought stubbornly. Metz brought more street-to-street combat, more house-to-house fighting. Third Army got them all, shot them out from their cover. Surrender of Metz opened the path for the great drive into Germany itself. This was the moment. The Siegfried Line was to be breached. The German sacred Rhine River was to be crossed. Then, on 16 December, plans went into eclipse. The bottom fell out. The enemy had one ace left in his military pack. He played it. The Germans quite literally threw everything they had into this last solid massed effort. They started their drive through the Ardennes, drove a deep salient into the Allied lines, widened it, blew it out to a bulge, engulfed Bastogne. They surrounded the town, but could not take it. Our troops there were isolated. Third Army was ordered to the rescue, to break the German iron ring encircling the town, to release the Americans trapped there. Relief of Bastogne became a battle cry. The Battle of the Bulge was on. Third Army started the greatest wheeling movement ever attempted in wartime logistics. An abrupt right-angle change in direction from a course already in operation by an entire army overnight. The bulk of 300,000 troops, with fighting gear and supplies, disengaged itself from contact with the enemy in the east, took a sharp turn north, plowed a path right through its own supply lines. This forced march had an atmosphere of unreality about it. Third Army had to contend with snow, sleet, mud, fog. Bitter winter weather was all on the side of the Germans. Tanks went out of control, skidded and slid. Sleet-covered roads brought their own war casualties in tanks and trucks. The troops in Bastogne held fast, waiting for the relief of the city by Third Army. Signal Corps men fought their Battle of the Bulge, too, against ice, snow, and freezing cold, kept Third Army lifelines of command open. Third Army arrived with guns firing. Bastogne became a kind of valley forge for the Third Army, but a valley forge with an enemy pounding in from all sides. Everything Third Army had on the ground went into action. One thing more would tie it all up into a quick victory package, attack by air. But the weather prayer be offered, a soldier's prayer, fair weather for battle. The prayer was made. Almighty and most merciful Father, restrain these immoderate rains. Grant us fair weather for battle. Establish thy justice among men and nations. Amen. Call it a miracle. The day before Christmas came as a real gift. Perfect flying weather. Our planes took to the air, poured it on the Germans. More planes followed, and more. Isolated Bastogne was fed by airdrop. Medical supplies went in. Ground forces kept pouring it on the Germans below. Destroyed them in the snow. 2 days after Christmas, Third Army broke the German lines, curled back their flanks, made first contact with the men in Bastogne. The siege of Bastogne was lifted. The German bulge finally deflated. Third Army turned its fighting strength against the Siegfried Line and the Rhine River. The Germans had no place to go now but home. But SS troops were in the way, so they stuck around, fought, gave themselves up, or were killed. Third Army tore its way through the dragon teeth of the Siegfried Line, came to the Rhine River and the German town of Frankfurt. Plans called for speed, but not recklessness. Our forces advanced cautiously. The trapped Germans were more dangerous than ever. The fighting at Frankfurt was of a piece with that along the length of the Rhine. Now, no place to hide. The Germans had come to the payoff. Third Army riflemen took them as they came, cut them up, destroyed them in isolated pockets. Frankfurt went the way of all the German towns. Their world was at its end. The German towns of Darmstadt, Hanau, Wiesbaden followed Frankfurt. It seems incredible, but is a fact. Third Army, under General Patton, never lost a battle. The great drive was nearing its last objective, the complete and total defeat of the Germans. The campaign in France, the Moselle, capture of Metz and the Saar campaign, Bastogne, forcing the Rhine, the capture of Trier, Koblenz, the Palatinate, Frankfurt. The way finally was open to the total collapse of all German-held land. Third Army overran the west of Germany. They fanned out and swept south, crossed the Danube. German armies were shot to pieces. Their disorganized leaders were captured or destroyed. Troops surrendered by whole divisions and corps. Generals gave up their batons, their battered armies, their now discredited authority. Germany's war was over. Third Army's fighting was over, with honor and glory enough for every Third Army man. Typical of the many honors to Third Army enlisted men and officers at different times and in different places was the ceremony at Lisch, Germany, where General Patton presented the Congressional Medal of Honor to Private Harold A. Garman. A fit tribute to the fighting spirit, to the loyalty of the troops of Third Army who fought the 281 days on the 1,000 miles of foreign soil are the words spoken by General Patton. There are men Third Army will never forget.
The American First Army, originally commanded by General Omar N. Bradley, later by General Courtney H. Hodges, stormed ashore on D-Day. After St. Lo, it drove east on a line somewhat parallel to that of the Third Army. Comparing the accomplishments of units is idle. But I personally believe the First Army, with its D-Day landings and its containment of Hitler's Ardennes offensive in December 1944, contributed as much or more to victory than did the Third. Nevertheless, because of his flamboyance and his checkered career, Patton got the headlines, and his Third Army got the lion's share of the credit in the press and elsewhere. While Third Army on the South was stopped by lack of supply, First Army was slowed by the heavily fortified Siegfried Line. Therefore, in early September 1944, the battle for Aachen began. Pushed to the border of their homeland, German defenses stiffened. As one of the gateways into Germany, the city was stubbornly and fiercely defended. On October 1st, however, 1 month to the day, 7th Corps, under the command of General J. Lawton Collins, surrounded and entered the city, and General Giraud's 5th Corps continued the attack toward the Roar River dams, as will be shown in our next video.
The city of Aachen was taken by the 1st United States Army on 21st October 1944, after a battle that raged for nearly 6 weeks. Out of this heap of rubble, the First Army would fashion its base for the next major Allied offensive. This was Aachen the day after its fall. The job of rehabilitation would not be easy. The chief rail station would have to be repaired. The electric power plant was out of operation, as well as the natural gas facilities. The military government section went to work, establishing order, restoring communications. The telephone system, for example, was salvaged when a former official of the company disclosed the hiding place of the city's telephone diagrams. Another problem for the AMG, food for the local population, was partially solved when hidden staples were discovered and hauled to a refugee camp outside the city limits. German civilians were pressed into service for this and other tasks. Soon Aachen was so well restored that refugees from the nearby internment camp were allowed to return to their homes in the city. This suburb of Aachen then became a rest center for the men of the 3rd Armored Division, where they had their first chance to relax since D-Day. A meal like this, for men long accustomed to cold fare, was a source of genuine pleasure. All up and down the line, rest centers were established throughout the First Army's area, stretching from Aachen to the southern tip of Luxembourg. At these, the men found relief after their drive across France and Belgium, and gathered the breath needed for their next offensive. Meanwhile, at the front, local actions characterized the pre-offensive period, in the south and in the north. Along the German border, while we were attacking an observation post, the distant church steeple, German mortars hidden nearby tried to knock out our battery, which continued to fire, making its mark. In the center of the First Army front, a local operation was being prepared at this time to precede the main drive. Although the attempt failed temporarily, the orders were to break out of the Hürtgen Forest and attack toward the Ruhr River and the Cologne Plain beyond. The 28th Division was assigned the task. It was to launch a three-pronged drive toward fortified towns controlling key roadways. In preparation for the attack, miles of roads had to be built through the heavily wooded area where the division had previously been pinned down. This section, near Aachen, begun late in October, was by the first week in November carrying American military traffic to and from the front. In other parts of the forest, another kind of preparation was underway: protection against the cold. Bivouacked close to the front, the men attended to last-minute details and took care of personal needs. The preliminary drive was launched on the morning of 2nd November, as men of the 28th Division, cautious, alert, moved through the woods which were alive with Germans. In the initial push toward Schmidt, our men fought steadily on, against an enemy that was unseen, but ever-present. The same morning, another regiment opened its attack in the center of the drive, directing its fire toward Vossenach. Our Air Force was up that day in support of the ground forces. The third spearhead, meanwhile, moved off as planned on the northern flank of the drive in the direction of Hurtgen Village. The men continued to advance for two more days in the face of mounting counterattacks. We took a lot of prisoners. Some of those captured in the northern push were rounded up for evacuation to the rear. Still more Germans poured in to an assembly area in the south, where they were questioned by one of their number and segregated according to their former Wehrmacht units. The stream of prisoners continued to mount until early in November the First Army registered the total captured since D-Day. Units of the 28th Division continued their action in the Hurtgen Forest against opposition so stiff as to make advance impossible. We held our ground with light artillery and anti-tank guns. With ready ingenuity, an abandoned tower was strung with telephone wire and converted into an observation post as we made a second attempt to take Schmidt. From here, the order to fire was transmitted to our tanks hidden in the woods below. And then came the snow, blanketing the front a week after the drive had started, adding the final difficulty to those under which the 28th Division was fighting. The men had to dig for protection underground in order to hold their hard-won positions in the Hurtgen Forest campaign. They had to struggle not only against a well-nigh impregnable enemy, but against the elements as well. In view of the unfavorable circumstances, Major General Leonard T. Giroux, commander of the 5th Corps, ordered on 9th November that the preliminary operation in Hurtgen Forest be called off. Guns were cleaned, oiled, and covered as the campaign drew to a temporary close. To meet the needs of swelling numbers of Allied troops on the march into Germany, the First Army opened a supply depot in Liège. This was designed to be the largest of its kind in the European theater of operations. It was only a part of the extensive preparations being made for the main drive. Anticipating the demands of the coming offensive, signal and communication facilities also were expanded, from rear areas forward. New transmission equipment of various kinds was received, installed, and put in use. Protected against air attack, the Hadir steelworks at Dieferdange, Luxembourg, taken over by the Supreme Command a month earlier, were providing the First Army with another essential need, heavy steel for construction and repair. The plant was run by the United States Corps of Engineers, who checked the finished beams before shipment to the front. Lumber, too, was needed. Sawmills in Luxembourg and in Germany were taken over and run by our engineers. Board planking like that used on the Hurtgen Forest roads was produced at this mill to build the roads that would lead us to Berlin. We had to repair and sometimes rebuild the bridges destroyed in the Battle of Belgium so that materiel could be rolled forward over the network of rivers. One of the bridges over the Meuse was restored so that again traffic might flow. Special equipment for our armored vehicles. A new type track connector was installed to better grip the mud under the tread of the 3rd Armored Division. A method of coping with Siegfried Line fortifications was devised. Our men found that the dragon's teeth could be effectively buried with the help of a tank dozer and some mud. Worn vehicles, which had already seen heavy duty in earlier campaigns, were being reconditioned to perform their part in the new offensive. The same snowfall which had halted operations in the Hurtgen Forest campaign augmented the problems of preparation and supply. Behind the lines, the tempo was accelerated as truck convoys rolled eastward in a continuous stream, building up a vast accumulation of food and equipment as the hour for attack approached. On 16 November, the First Army struck to clear the area to the rear in the direction of the Cologne Plain. The main effort of the First Army's drive would be borne by three divisions of the 7th Corps. They would move north of the forest and along the superhighway from Aachen toward Düren. This part of the operation would be carried out in two parallel drives. The 1st Infantry and 3rd Armored Divisions would thrust eastward through Mausbach, while the 104th Division would push north after clearing Stolberg. The morning of the attack, on the outskirts of Aachen, barrage balloons manned by the British were floated eastward to mark the line of enemy positions to be bombed. This was the first time that barrage balloons were used for this purpose. Later that morning, our planes came over, bombers and fighter bombers, British and American. They softened up the tough road that the 1st and 9th Armies would follow in their joint attack to the rear. Our strategic bombers struck the key city of Düren, straddling the Ruhr River. Düren had been converted into a strong point by the German High Command to compensate for the loss of Aachen. The civilian population had been evacuated. The buildings were forts, storehouses, and billets. No advance to the Ruhr or beyond it was possible without the neutralization of Düren. We dropped a saturation load that day, chiefly fragmentation bombs and incendiaries. They set huge fires, the smoke from which was visible for miles. Scanning the skies to note the end of the air raid, ground forces waited for the signal to attack. All armor was put in readiness. Camouflage nets were removed. The color plaques mounted on their vehicles served to identify them to the air forces. This reconnaissance group was scheduled to lead the 104th Division's drive through Stolberg. Following the briefing shortly after noon on 16th November, the first section moved off to deploy along the road for reconnaissance. The following day, ground troops of the division stood by, waiting the order to join the attack on Stolberg. They advanced along a forest trail in a flanking movement designed to relieve pressure on two of our battalions which had been pinned down inside the forest. Assault guns of the 3rd Armored Division covered their movement from positions bordering the line of attack. The result of German counterfire. One of our battalion command posts near Stolberg was completely knocked out by a direct artillery hit. Several American soldiers were wounded. The debris was so heavy in some places that one of their vehicles was buried up to the windshield. German townsfolk were injured by their own guns. This woman and other civilians received first aid from our medics. On 19th November, the 9th Air Force flew through heavy flak in support of the 1st as well as the 9th Army. 1,600 planes attacked frontline defenses that day. They strafed the Germans dug in at Stolberg, who were holding up our advance. Fortified houses surrounding the town were peppered by our machine gunners. And they were being hit by heavy guns like this M12, which could be speedily maneuvered under its own propulsion. Massed 3rd Armored Division tanks acted as artillery to pour in volley after volley of fire. And this, at last, cracked the defenses of Stolberg. The town was left to the remnants of the civilian population, who were beginning to taste the meaning of war on their own soil as they moved their belongings out of the battered city. Stolberg was finally cleared on 21st November by the 104th Division. The town had been strewn with booby traps and mines. In some cases, it was necessary to blast structures which could not otherwise be cleared. Two weeks later, the American flag flew over the city. While some units were busy cleaning up Stolberg, Others had pushed north to enter Eschweiler on 20th November. This was the largest German city between Aachen and Düren. Quiet on the exterior, the city was alive with snipers. Mopping up began at once and continued for 2 days. Prisoners ferreted out of their hiding places were gathered into the net. In other parts of the city, the hunt for holdouts continued. Some of our infantry cruised the city streets on tanks as they searched out the enemy. By the end of the second day, we had virtually cleared Eschweiler of all its defenders, and our men were able to look forward to a dry night's sleep. Roadblocks like this, where the enemy had dynamited an overhead bridge, were rapidly cleared by our engineers. As a seal of victory, a military government unit arrived to take over the city's administration. On the following day, the attack pushed on from the outskirts of Eschweiler toward the next town to the east, Weißweiler, which fell to our troops 2 days later. As the line of attack pressed forward, we approached Frentz, which lay across the Indy River. With all roads leading to the town under German fire, and with all bridges blown, our engineers had to bridge the river in order to enable the division to advance. An hour and a half after construction had started, the first jeep raced across the completed bridge. The attack on Frentz progressed rapidly as heavy artillery was brought up to the line, and on 28th November the town was ours. The 104th Division hammered at enemy defenses for another 5 days, fighting its way across the Indy River to take two more towns, thus carving off 4/5 of the way to the rear. Meanwhile, in the Mausbach area to the south, rockets launched the 3rd Armored Division's drive to the river. They blasted the opening wedge for this attack that would move eastward in a parallel line. This was the first time that rockets of this kind were used by the 1st Army. 75 launchers loosened 600 projectiles in a single volley. In the first 30 minutes of the attack, they fired 1,800 rockets. Immediately following the barrage, a task force covered by our tanks moved out from Mausbach toward Gräsnig, their first objective. German guns got the range on the column and knocked out one of our vehicles. But the column continued to move ahead under the protection of our tanks. Lined up in artillery array, they flanked the advancing task force and rained fire on the enemy in Gräsnig. The enemy, however, held us outside the town for 2 days. It was essential to keep a constant stream of armor moving up and forward. While some elements were struggling to advance, new units were brought up to the line. Every tank, every gun was needed, so that the 3rd Armored Division could operate effectively in the center of the drive, supporting one infantry division on the north and another on the south. Men were needed too. Troops of the 1st Infantry Division were moving up through the forest near Aachen to break the enemy defense lines, separating us from the rear. They were on their way to Gräsnig. Using a ruined factory as an observation post, the attack was renewed. From this vantage point, we could shell and hit the Germans entrenched inside the town. From the edges of the forest, our men moved forward to exploit the work of the artillery units. Continuing to advance until late that day, they finally captured Gräsnig on 19th November. Following up the advantage, our armor pressed forward, opening an attack on Werth, another strongly defended town. During one phase of the operation, some of our tanks had to move out over the open fields, where the tanks themselves were the only cover for our infantry. German counterfire was strong and accurate, hitting the lead tank and wounding its commander. Approaching Verth from another direction, men of the 1st Division entered the town, which was under enemy mortar fire. We had to fight for Verth, every inch of it, hugging the buildings for protection, hunting out snipers concealed in the shells of houses, ducking into ruins for shelter. Despite the tough resistance, however, the fanatic foe at last surrendered, and by the evening of 19th November, Verth, too, had been secured. For the next 2 weeks, the First Army continued to advance, fighting through the almost impregnable wall of closely spaced German towns, towns which had been skillfully fortified and bitterly defended, towns like this one, Hamich, which the 1st Division captured on 20th November and from which it pressed onward. On the march to the Ruhr, these troops moved ahead to punch their way through the next ring of towns blocking their path to the Ruhr. Food and ammunition kept rolling forward despite the handicap of weather. While the main effort progressed in the Stolberg-Eschweiler area, the 4th and 8th Infantry Divisions renewed the previous offensive in the Hürtgen Forest. On the northern fringe, the 4th Division pushed off on 16th November. With field guns supporting the action, this second attempt to clear the Hürtgen Forest got underway. Our men, advancing through the woods, were sometimes scattered by enemy fire, but they kept on going, inching their way forward. Sometimes they were pinned down, but they crawled ahead. Casualties were heavy in all parts of the forest, but they received prompt attention from our ever-vigilant medical corps. Communications and heavy armor were brought up to support the infantry further up the hill. The advance continued successfully as the 4th Division drove on towards its objective, the town of Grosshau, where it crushed the last German resistance on 28th November. With continuous artillery support, this division was able to fulfill its assignment in the Hürtgen Forest campaign. The 8th Division joined the action by attacking objectives in the heart of the forest. Supported by one combat command of the 5th Armored Division, it launched its drive on the morning of 26th November with a rocket barrage. The rockets were firing at enemy positions in Kleinhau. It was estimated in the field that one such battery equaled the light artillery power of 5 divisions. Air support came the following day, when fighter bombers flew more than 1,000 sorties over the area. Then the artillery took over, concentrating on the target at close range, and 2 days later, Kleinhau was captured. Hürtgen II was finally cleared and secured late in November. One of the major objectives of the earlier campaign, Hürtgen presented a shell-shattered face to the weary men of the 8th Division who had battled for the town. Turning south, the division moved on to take 2 more towns, Brandenburg and Bergstein, and then they proceeded to mop up the remaining German positions between them and the Ruhr River. At last, these troops had a chance to relax. They had succeeded in clearing the Hürtgen Forest, and by 8th December had established one sector of the 1st Army front along the west bank of the Ruhr. Troop replacements were effected during the first week in December when the 1st Army paused before completing the drive. The 9th Infantry Division, fresh from a rest center in Belgium, moved up. It was on its way to relieve the battle-worn 1st Infantry Division, which had been in continuous action since the drive began. As the convoys passed each other, the 9th moved forward to take up positions at the front. Relief and relocations were also taking place in other areas during this brief lull in the fighting, as the 1st Army gathered the strength needed for its final leap to the Ruhr River. One thrust of the new drive was launched early on 10th December from this town, Lückeburg, which had been hotly contested. Attacking through Inden, we began to close in on Pier. On 12th December, after days of stubborn resistance, Pier showed the effects of the battle for its possession. the 104th Division moved on to wipe out German resistance along the west bank of the Ruhr north of Düren. At the same time, the 3rd Armored Division pushed through another string of German towns defending Düren, separating the 1st Army from the Ruhr in this area. It opened the attack on 10th December by shelling Schlich, one of the remaining strong points west of Düren. Men of the newly arrived 9th Infantry Division went into action in close coordination with the 3rd Armored Division. Objectives in Schlich are visible in the distance. Following the artillery barrage, armor and men moved forward with a new piece of equipment, a rotary mine exploder. While the column pressed doggedly onward, infantrymen rounded up some of the enemy whom they found hidden along the path of advance. Up ahead, our men had to dig for what shelter they could find. The lead tank had been hit. The fire spreading caused a series of explosions. Meanwhile, gunners at closer range continued the attack, pouring in a steady stream of fire until late in the day when the ceasefire order was given. Resistance in Schlich was quelled. The following day, 11th December, those defenders who had survived were assembled for questioning and inspection. The next objective, the strongly defended town of Geik, was already aflame from German and American shellfire when the 3rd Armored Division bore down upon it. Men and guns moved out first. A smoke screen was thrown up to cover the movement as the heavy armor swung into line. As the men entered the town, they found it wrecked and empty of human life. In other parts of the town, the fires burned on unchecked. They gave concrete evidence that the 3rd Armored Division had cleared the enemy from still one more section along the 1st Army front. Simultaneously, from the fringes of the Hürtgen Forest, the last of the three final drives got underway. Armor moved up and forward to strengthen and broaden the attack. Infantry of the 83rd Division, recently brought up to the line, were marching toward the last objective in this campaign, a suburb of Düren. By 13th December, we were driving the enemy ahead of us, pinning their backs to the river. The attack to clear the town, Gerzenich, began the same day. Our infantry was alert to sniper fire from the enemy, hidden and protected. In some parts of the town, resistance was so great that it was necessary to blast the Germans out of concealment and to hunt them out individually, both inside the city and on the outskirts. Among those taken prisoner were a number of women who had been collaborating with German soldiers. As our men rounded up the remnants of the fanatic forces defending the Ruhr, they were bringing to a successful finish the tough campaign launched a month earlier from Aachen. The 1st Army had won through to its objective and stood ready to pursue the foe in the next phase of the offensive into the heart of Germany. We'll be right back.